But this wire, USB will be there. Connect the USB. It's done, madam. After starting,
morning to all. Welcome to today's presentation on Rankine Cycle with Regeneration. So far, we had a discussion on different methods involved in improvement of performance of the Rankine Cycle. Those discussed the topics are improvement of performance of the steam power plant, that is Rankine Cycle, by means of superheating. The first method is the superheating, or by increasing the boiler pressure. These are the very fundamental methods to improve the performance of Rankine Cycle. Apart from these methods, the source temperature can be increased. That is called as, also called as superheating, degree of superheating. A sink temperature can be decreased as per the Carnot theorem. And the different methods of reheating in a boiler, that is the steam, after the expansion of the steam in the high pressure steam turbine, the steam can be supplied to the boiler again, then that is going to the reheating coil, the temperature of the steam is increased. So, the performance is increased in the reheating, as well as the quality of the steam at the exit of the turbine also will increase. So, the life of the steam turbine will increase by means of this reheating. And next method is regeneration. What we have discussed today, the main focus is on regeneration. The main objective of this regeneration is improvement of the efficiency, thermal efficiency of the steam Rankine Cycle. Regenerator is this one type of heat exchanger, where the one side the feed water is supplied, another side the steam is supplied. So, steam is the hot fluid and the cold fluid is the feed water. So, the temperature of feed water is increased, then automatically the efficiency of the Rankine Cycle will increase. The main idea of this regeneration is coming from the Carnotization. Idea of this regeneration is coming from the Carnot Cycle. You know, the Carnot Cycle has four fundamental process. The TS diagram, the heat supply at the constant temperature, heat rejection is also at constant temperature process, and this is the expansion, isentropic expansion, and this is the isentropic compression process. Let us take this is 1, 2, 3, 4 is the Carnot Cycle. In this Carnot Cycle, the isothermal heat addition is the temperature is constant, isothermal heat rejection, here also temperature is constant. But in Rankine Cycle, it won't obey the Carnot Cycle, that's why the Rankine Cycle efficiency is less than the Carnot Cycle efficiency. But as an engineer, thermal engineer can practice how to improve the efficiency of this Rankine Cycle towards this Carnot Cycle. This we are calling as Carnot Cycle. Coming to this Rankine Cycle, see, let us see the Rankine Cycle how it looks. The same TS diagram. In Rankine Cycle, since it is a vapor power cycle, first we have to draw a vapor dome. This is a typical vapor dome. This is the heat addition and this is the heat rejection. So, fortunately, the heat addition and heat rejection, partially it is isothermal, that is the temperature is constant, even the pressure is also kept constant. Constant pressure process. This is a superheating of the steam. After superheating, it is expanded in a Rankine Cycle, steam turbine of the Rankine Cycle. Then heat is rejected in the condenser. This is the boiler. Now, after condensing this expanded steam, it is completely condensed in the saturated liquid and water, and it is pumped to the boiler pressure. Then heat is supplied. But here heat supply is three parts, we can say. Let us say this 1, 2 is the expansion process, 2 to 3 is the condensation, and 3 to 4 is the pumping process. Now 4 to 1 is the heat addition. This is the sensible heat transfer and this is the latent heat transfer. Again, it is a sensible heat transfer. It is not constant, and temperature is only in the evaporator section only it is constant. Other than this superheating and feed water heating, the temperature is variable. That's why it's not similar to the Carnot Cycle. But here, if we are modifying here, then there is a possibility to achieve towards the coronization. Now, this I am showing this expansion is a wet expansion, that is a dry expansion. Similarly, there is a wet expansion also may be possible. This also expansion, but it is a dry saturated steam is expanded here. Here saturated steam is expanded. Here superheated steam is expanded. Now, there are three vertical lines are shown here. One is superheat steam is expanded in the turbine, and dry saturated steam is expanded in the turbine, and here the wet steam is expanded in the turbine. But here superheating ensures always the state of the steam is in dry condition. So, there is no much erosion and corrosion in the steam turbine. That is the main advantage of this superheating. Now, currently we are focusing on the regeneration. That is why let us focus on the cycle, that is from here to here. Because it is a vertical line, looking vertical line, isentropic expansion process, ideally hypothetically, and this is the condensation process. Now see, if some heat is transferred from here to here, some heat is transferred from the steam, from this point to this point, so the steam is, steam turbine is working as a heat exchanger, as an expander. Now this steam can be transferred. Steam can be transferred to heat the feed water from this temperature to this temperature. So, now this temperature to this temperature, now you are supplying the heat from this point to this point only. The new Rankine cycle looks like this. Now heat supplied from here to here and it is expanded and this is condensed and this is pumped and here pumped and temperature of steam is increasing from this point continuously by means of this feed water heating. So, this heat is transferred and here now heat supply is now 1, 2, 3, 4 is a pumping and 4 to 4 dash is a, that is a feed water heating. Now, heat supply is only from 4 dash to 1. Heat supply is only from the 4-1. Now see the shaded area. This shaded area is equal to this shaded area. If I am drawing this line, and this area and this area is equal. Now this heat is transferred to this feed water heating. The temperature of, ideally the temperature of feed water is equal to the saturation temperature in the boiler. So, this is called as ideal regeneration, that is a feed water heater, temperature is increased by taking the heat from the steam. But here practically there is so many difficulties are there, what difficulties are there, it is difficult to design a steam turbine which is working as both expander, that is a turbine function, as well as a heat transfer process, that is a heat exchanger process. Practically it is difficult to implement this part of equipment. That's why this process is separated and this process is separated in the actual regeneration process. In actual regeneration process, we can implement two ways. That's why there is a separate equipment is required, that is called as feed water heater. The regeneration is achieved by means of this heat exchanger in feed water heater. The feed water heater may be open type, open feed water heater, FWH, open feed water heater, or it may be a closed feed water heater. It may be a open feed water heater or closed feed water heater. The main objective of this feed water heater is to raise the temperature of feed water before entering into the boiler to some extent more than that earlier temperature, but below the steam saturation temperature. So, in open feed water heater, some portion of steam is taken from the steam turbine. See, steam is coming from the steam turbine here. This is the steam. Steam is coming from the steam turbine and here the feed water before entering into the boiler is supplied. This is the steam and this is the water. The steam is completely condensed. By transferring the latent heat of steam to the water temperature is increased. The water temperature is increased from this point to this point, that state to this state. So you are heating very hot water relatively without feed water heating system. Now you are feeding a hot water into the boiler relatively high temperature earlier before that feed water heating system. Before, for example, if it is a 48 degree centigrade, now you may achieve more than 48 degree centigrade. Let us take this is around 70 degree centigrade. That depends upon the temperature of the steam. The feed water exit temperature is less than the steam temperature. This is the steam, that is a wet, maybe wet steam or saturated steam, that depends upon the pressure and the temperature condition. So this is the concept of this open feed water heater. This is also called as deaerator. Why it is also called as deaerator? The dissolved gases. See here, mostly the water is completely condensed into the water. Now H2 only is able to condense. The water, pure water only, the steam only able to condense into the liquid form. Whatever the other gases, for example, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, oxygen, etc., air is there, then that won't condense. That's why there is a small hole is there here that allows the gases. They are not possible to condense. This is the air plus gases. The air plus gas is escaped from the deaerator, that is the open feed water heater. So it improves the performance of this entire Rankine cycle. Otherwise, the trapping of this air and the gas traces in the water decreases the heat transfer coefficient. The thermal properties will affect by means of this mixing of this air as well as the gas traces in the water that we have to remove from the Rankine cycle continuously. That's why in the Rankine cycle, the deaerator is a mandatory component. Without deaerator, we should not use the Rankine cycle based on this concept. That is, we have to remove the dissolved gases from the working fluid, that is the water. That's why at least one open feed water heating system is mandatory in the Rankine cycle. That is the operation of a thermal power plant. Now, the second case is the closed feed water heating system. As the name indicates, is that what type of heat exchanger? It's a closed type, that is indirect. This is a direct contact. This heat transfer nature is direct. The hot fluid as well as the cold fluid is directly mixed with each other. That's why it is a direct type of heat exchanger. Whereas in the closed feed water heater, this is the indirect. The meaning of this indirect means there is no mixing of hot fluid with the cold fluid. Hot fluid lines are different as well as the cold fluid lines are different. For example, in a typical heat exchanger, a closed feed heat exchanger, this is a water coil. Here steam is entering from the turbine. Steam from the turbine is entering into the closed feed water heater. This is a closed feed water heater. Now steam is rejecting heat to the water. This is the feed water coming from the condenser. Feed water is coming from the condenser. And this is the heated feed water. Now the temperature of feed water is increased before entering into the boiler. Now it is going to the boiler. So the temperature is increased from here to here, but there is no any function of deaeration. Simply it is working as a regenerator. It's not two functions. Earlier it is open feed water heater, there are two functions. One is rising the temperature. So it is helping to increase the efficiency of the Rankine cycle, because once the water temperature is increased, the amount of coal burned in the furnace, boiler furnace, automatically it will decrease. That's why the heat input is decreased in the Rankine cycle, automatically the efficiency will improve. Here also the temperature of water is increasing, that's why it is saving the fuel consumption in the furnace, that is the boiler. So it is also helping the improvement in the efficiency, but it is not doing this function, that is removing the traces of the gases as well there. That's why it is only feed water heater, that's why it is regenerator. There is no any restrictions, rules and restrictions of this closed feed water heater, but anyhow, we are in the real thermal power plant is a combination of both open feed water heaters as well as the closed feed water heaters we are practicing. Now, the steam is completely condensed here, it's again taken out to enter into the boiler. So, this is the difference between the open feed water heater as well as the closed feed water heater. Now, let us have a discussion on how this feed water heaters perform in a Rankine cycle. How the Rankine cycle efficiency will increase by incorporating this open feed water heater as well as the closed feed water heater. Now, see the regenerative Rankine cycle I am drawing now. The regenerative Rankine cycle. First, I am drawing a schematic sketch of this closed system. This is a typical boiler operating with furnace. Coal is entered here and the firing is coming in the furnace, and the superheated steam is coming from the boiler. It is supplied to a steam turbine. And then it is expanding and entered into condenser. Where circulating water is entering here and then it is condensing into the liquid form. This is saturated liquid, saturated water in Rankine cycle. And it has to pump to the boiler. As it is pumping, but here what it is doing here, in the regenerator, what we have to do, we have to trap some portion of steam from the turbine. We have to trap some portion of steam from the turbine, and it is connected to a open feed water heater. This is a typical open feed water heater, and this pumped water is supplied to the feed water heating system, and both are mixed together. That is the steam as well as this water, pumped water is mixed together, and then it is again pumping back the boiler pressure. It is pumping back to the boiler pressure. Now see, let us see how it is performing the flow diagram. This is one is a state of superheated steam at the inlet of the steam turbine, and two is a state of the steam, that is a trapped steam for the deaerator. And this is the condenser and this boiler, and this is there are two pumps are there. This pump is raising the pressure from the condenser pressure to the deaerator pressure. The second pump is raising the pressure from the deaerator pressure to the boiler pressure. That's why there are two pumps are required. Now it is expanding to three. So 1, 2, 3 is the expansion process, and 3, 4 is the condensation process, and 4, 5. Is a pumping from low pressure to the deaerator pressure. It may be, you may call as intermediate pressure, and it is after condensing the state, you can call this as 6, and 6 to 7 is one more pumping process, that is from the deaerator pressure to the boiler pressure. Now here process is the mixing process is happening in the deaerator, that is open feed water heater. The steam plus water, that is 2 plus 5 is equal the saturated liquid, that is 6. The steam is mixing, that is steam 2 is mixing with the steam 5, and the resultant steam is say 6. So this can be represented for easy convenience on the TS diagram. To read the TS diagram, especially to execute the Rankine cycle for thermodynamic evaluation, the PV as well as TS diagram is, but the TS diagram is more convenient for the practicing and solving this Rankine cycle. So I am drawing this TS diagram for regenerative Rankine cycle. See, this is a superheated steam, and it is expanding in a steam turbine. but you are taking some portion of steam. Let us take this is a steam taken out from the turbine, taken out from the turbine, which is expanding. After pumping, it is pumped water. This steam and this water both are mixed together, and the resultant is a saturated liquid. Again, it is pumped back to the boiler pressure and heat is applied. Now, see here is one state 1 and state 2, 3, 4, and 4 to 5 is the first pumping process, and 2 plus 5 is equal to 2, state 2 plus state 5 is equal to state 6. State 6 is the saturated liquid condition. Again, from 6 to 7, the subsequent pumping is there. So 7 to 1 is the heat addition. This is a sensible heat transfer. This is a latent heat transfer. Again, this is a sensible heat transfer. But now see, compared to earlier, that is without any regeneration, without using any feed water heater, now the boiler load is from here to here, that is from 5 to 1. Now the boiler load is decreased. Instead of heating from the temperature of T5, now we are increasing from T7 to T1 only. The load in the boiler is decreased. heat addition is decreased. So automatically efficiency will improve. Now the question is, how much steam we have to take out from the steam turbine to achieve the resultant state of saturated liquid condition? That is simply by means of mass balance and energy balance. The simplification of the mass balance as well as this energy balance, that is heat balance equation, gives us the amount of steam required for this requirement of the deaerator function or the feed water function. Let us see how for example, this is 1 kg per second of steam is entering in the turbine, and you are trapping m kg per second of steam for feed water heating system. The balance is 1 minus m kg. 1 minus m kg per second steam is entering the condenser. So after mixing, how much steam is here, resultant steam here? Same as one should be 1 kg per second, because this is m kg per second is mixing with the 1 minus m kg. M plus 1 minus m, that is again, this is 1 kg per second. So that is the mass balance is finished. Entire loops, there are 2 loops are there here. Entire loop, the mass balance is over. Coming to the heat balance or the energy balance, the total heat before mixing is equal to total heat after mixing. So assuming there is no any heat transfer losses to the surroundings, the heat exchanger is insulated well, it's not allowing any heat loss to the surroundings. Assuming that assumption, then we can apply this balance equation, that is 2 plus 5 is equal to 6, that is 2 means what is mass here, mass is m, and corresponding energy is enthalpy, that is h. M into h2 is the energy content of this steam coming from the turbine, and at the 5 the mass is 1 minus m. The city's mass is 1 minus m. The energy is H5. Energy is H5. The resultant is 6. That is 1 kg. The resultant is 1 kg. 1 into all the energies, that is H1, H2, H3, everything we can determine either from the steam tables in the analytical approach method, are the Mulliger chart that we are going to discuss in the numerical part. Now coming to the concept of this regenerative Rankine cycle, that is here unknown is m. By simplification of this equation, we can find this unknown m, that is the amount of steam to be required for the feed water heating system, plus H5 minus m into H5 is equal to H6. So m into H2 minus H5 is equal to H6 minus H5. So therefore, finally, m is equal to amount of steam to be required is equal to 6 minus h5 divided by h2 minus h5. So this steam is calculated. Steam is calculated to find the efficiency of this regenerative Rankine cycle. To find this efficiency of this regenerative Rankine cycle, now earlier output is different. Earlier output is directly this 1 kg per second 1 into h1 minus h3, but here some steam is used for regenerator. Definitely the output from the steam turbine will decrease compared to the simple Rankine cycle. That is one of the drawbacks. Even the output is decreasing, but even the output is decreasing, here the save in the heat input, overall the efficiency will increase. Now see how much power you can calculate. W net is equal, that is our, from the steam turbine you may say this is 1 into h1 minus h2 plus, coming to the second steam turbine, second expansion, subsequent expansion, its mass is 1 minus m, 1 minus m into h2 minus h3. What is minus pump work? How many pumps here? There are two pumps are there here. This pump is 1 minus m into h5 minus h4 plus second pump input is this is 1 kg. 1 into h7 minus h3. So the turbine output minus pump input. The turbine output minus pump input is the net output from the Rankine cycle. This is the net output from the Rankine cycle. Now heat input is here to here, that is 21 is equal 1 into h1 minus h7. Is decreased. So efficiency of this thermal efficiency of this Rankine cycle is, that is W net by heat supply into 100. This is the improved efficiency from the Rankine cycle. That is using this open feed water heater system, the efficiency of this Rankine cycle is improved. But here the work output is decreasing. There are two effects. One is output is decreased, but efficiency is because carnotization means mostly the main primary focus is improvement in the efficiency. Now the second method is closed feed water heating system, that is regenerative Rankine cycle. With closed feed water heater. Regenerative Rankine cycle with the closed feed water heater. Now let us discuss with the schematic flow diagram of this regenerative Rankine cycle. Similar to the earlier flow diagram, there is a furnace and this boiler. Steam is generated in the boiler. The steam is supplied to a turbine, steam turbine. It's expanded, entering into the condenser. Heat is rejected to the surroundings, Q2. Heat supplied to the boiler is Q1. This is the output from the steam turbine. Now, see, after this condensation, after condensation, now some steam is taken out, same like earlier case. Now this steam is pumped, here it is pumped, and it is entering into the feed water heater, but this is closed feed water heater. That's why I am using this coil type of heat exchanger. In a closed feed water heater, the steam is entering here, that is the bleed steam is entering in the closed feed water heater, in the feed water heater. But there is no any mixing contact between the hot fluid as well as the cold fluid. Simply the temperature of feed water heater is increasing from this state to this state. Now this is completely condensed. The steam is completely condensed by rejecting the latent heat to the water. Now this water is again mixing to this feed water, and then it is pumped. Second pump is there. From this pump, it is supplied to the boiler. Now see here, supplied to the boiler. So here also two pumps are there. One is used before the feed water heating system. The second is used for to raise the pressure to the boiler. Now the temperature is increased from here to here in the feed water. That's why the efficiency will increase as per our earlier discussion. Coming to the states, that is notations. One is the state at the inlet of the steam turbine. Turbine inlet temperature is T1, and two is the amount of the state steam is where steam is taken out from steam turbine, and after expansion the state is 3, and 3 to 4 is condensation process, and 4 to 5 is the pumping, the first pumping. And now see 5 to 6 is the feed water heating system, that is the water temperature is increased from 5 to 6 and steam is condensed from 2 to, let us say this is 7, 2 to 7, and then you can see the it's mixed. Again it is pumping back to the boiler pressure. After mixing, that is 7 plus 6 is equal to, you may call this as 8, and 8 to 9 is a pumping process. Now on the Rankine cycle CS diagram, this is the vapor dome, the condensation, the boiling, the steam is taken out here, this is the black steam. Water pump, this is the pumping process. One is the pumping process, this 4 to 5, this is 1, 2, 3. 3 to 4 is the condensation process, similar to the earlier open feed water heating system. Now, after that, here the temperature of water is increased, but this temperature is and the saturation temperature of the steam. For example, this is the saturation temperature of the steam. After heating, the temperature should be less than this temperature, because in the heat closed feed water heater system, the terminal temperature difference should be maintained. The terminal temperature difference is difference between the saturation temperature as well as the water temperature at the exit of feed water heater system. That is the terminal temperature difference. The saturation temperature at this pressure P2, terminal temperature difference is equal to saturation temperature at the state 2. And call this as state 2 minus water temperature at the exit of feed water heating system, that is a closed feed water heater, that is T6. So this temperature T6 is less than the saturation temperature. Now after heating, it's mixed again, it is mixed with this temperature. Now after mixing you will get, this is the resultant temperature. After mixing, again one more pumping process is there. This is again heat transfer here. So here 1, 2, 3, 4 to 5 is the pumping process, and 5 to 6 small heat rise is there. After 6 it is mixing, that is 8. This is 8 is mixing, and 8 to 9 is the pumping process. So here also the temperature is increased, but it's not the direct mixing. Earlier after mixing, the resultant mixing point is here. But here pumping is 8 to 9, 9 to 1 is the heat addition process. This is 1 kg per second, this is m, this is 1 minus. Here also we can apply this mass balance as well as energy balance equations. As mass balance shows is 1 kg, out of 1 kg mk is taken out, the balance is 1 minus mkg. As steam is expanded in the subsequent expander, and here this is mkg. After mixing this 1 mkg with 1 minus m, again it is the 1 kg per second. Now this energy balance slightly differs with the open feed water heating system. Now see here, the heat before heat transfer is total heat before transfer is 2 plus 5. After heat transfer, the state is 6, and here the state is 7. State is 7. 7 is completely saturated here. Completely saturated. Now see M2 means M here. M into H2, plus here 1 minus M, 1 minus M into, what is the state here, 5, H5. After mixing, there are two states are there, one is 6, second one is 7. The 6 means 1 minus M, 1 minus M of H6, the energy is H6. Coming to the 7, the mass is M plus M into H7, plus M into H7. What is unknown here from this energy balance equation? M is unknown. The enthalpies we can, anyhow, enthalpies we can work out from the tables as well as the Mollier chart. But the mass balance, from the mass balance and the energy balance, we have to find out this mass after simplification of this energy equation. M into H2. Plus H5 minus M into H5 is equal to H6 minus M into H6 plus M7. M into H7. So here M into H2 minus M into H5 minus M into H6 plus M into H7. This can be simplified here, that is M into H2 minus H5, here minus means plus H6, plus means minus H7 is equal, the balance is H6, the right hand side H6, minus here H5 is there, minus H5. Therefore, M is equal to H6 minus H5 divided by H2 minus H5 plus H6 minus H5. So, from this equation, we can find this mass required to feed the water temperature from 5 to 6 as per the constraints or the assumptions. Here, the assumptions are one is the terminal temperature difference. The second one is the location of this feed water heater. The location of this feed water heater plays an important role in the efficiency calculation as well as maximum efficiency. We have to select a best location for this feed water heater pressure, because we know the this pressure P1 is the boiler pressure and P3 is the condenser pressure. Once boiler pressure is increased, obviously, the efficiency, the output also will increase up to certain extent, will increase in the boiler pressure. By decreasing this condenser pressure, that is decreasing the sink temperature, the efficiency as well as the output, that is the performance of the Rankine cycle, will increase. But we don't know how to maintain this feed water heater pressure, whether we have to increase this feed water heater pressure or we have to decrease the feed water heater pressure, that we have to analyze. So, to analyze this location, there is one temperature difference is introduced here. The temperature difference is, for example, here let us define three temperatures. see, this is the saturation temperature 1, or you can call this as saturation temperature of boiler. This is the saturation temperature 3, you may define this as saturation temperature of the condenser. And this is the 2, that is the saturation temperature of the state 2. Saturation temperature, you may call this as feed water heater. Just simply say F. F stands for feed water heater. For feed water heater, now we have to find this temperature. Now to analyze this one, let us see the difference, this difference and the total difference. The ratio can be varied. Instead of changing this temperature from condenser temperature to the boiler temperature, let us vary the ratio, that is the temperature ratio, we may call it as theta, and we may analyze the efficiency of this regenerator Rankine cycle. Now the theta is defined as the temperature difference between the feed, this temperature, that is feed water heater, and the condenser, that is a saturation temperature in the feed water heater minus saturation temperature in the condenser by total temperature difference. The total temperature difference in the Rankine cycle is difference between the boiler and the condenser, that's all. That is the saturation temperature in the boiler minus saturation temperature in the condenser. This is the overall temperature difference. For example, if the feed water heater temperature is maintained at the condenser temperature, the theta becomes 0. The theta becomes 0. There is no any regenerator. This is simply Rankine cycle. Simple Rankine cycle. If the feed water heater temperature is maintained at the boiler temperature, it is the ideal cycle. That is, the theta is equal to 1. It's not possible. Ideal cycle is also not possible. Theta is equal to 0 is simply, it is without any feed water heating system. That is a simple Rankine cycle. The actual Rankine cycle means here the temperature of the feed water heater temperature, saturation temperature is maintained between the condenser temperature as well as the boiler temperature. That can be increased between 0 and 1. So, between 0 and 1 means the theta is changing from 0 to 1 indicates the feed water heater pressure is slowly, it is increasing, the pressure as well as temperature slowly it is increasing from the condenser state to the boiler state. Now let us see how the efficiency is increasing or changing. The efficiency of this Rankine cycle, regenerative Rankine cycle, is increasing with increasing the theta, with increasing the theta, and attaining the maximum condition, attaining the maximum condition, and followed by a drop in the efficiency. So one particular value of this location, the efficiency is getting maximum. The corresponding feed water heater location, corresponding feed water heater location, the theta becomes 0.5. So at ideal case, this is ideal case, assuming the turbine, if isentropic efficiency of the turbine is 100%, turbine is steam turbine is 100%, you may get, without any irreversibilities in the turbine, you may get the deaerator location is between the condenser as well as the boiler, exactly at the midpoint. Point for me is exactly at the midpoint. For example, this is at 200 degrees centigrade and this is at let us say 50 degrees centigrade. The temperature should be the midpoint of 200 as well as the 50. That is, you can take the midpoint of this 50 and as well as the 200. That temperature, at this temperature, you can find this saturation pressure corresponding to the feed water heater temperature. At that pressure, you can maintain the entire regenerator cycle. So, this easy to, for now, it is easy to determine the location of this feed water heater to result a maximum efficiency for the Rankine cycle. But here the efficiency differs with the isentropic efficiency. Obviously here the theta may not be 0.5, that we have to analyze the case to case, because in the real power plant we have to get the data from the machines, that is the turbo machines. As per the realistic data, we have to analyze this again, the performance data of this feed water heating system with the ideal case. But in the expansion, the actual expansion, slightly there is a deviation of this state and exit of the turbine that we can calculate from the isentropic efficiency of the steam turbine. For example, see here a steam turbine. Steam is expanding from one pressure to other pressure, that is, let us say this is P1 to P2. In ideal case, this is 1, 2 dash, in real case, 1. See, 1, 2 is the expansion, it is the actual expansion. Actual expansion is because of the dissipative effect in the steam turbine. 1, 2 is hypothetical expansion. This is why it is called hypothetical isentropic process. That is, S1 is equal to S. Adiabatic expansion is different and isentropic expansion is different. Here both you may call this as adiabatic expansions only. Both are well insulated. That is, 1, 2 dash as well as 1, 2. Both are well insulated. But the adiabatic expansion only, but this is reversible adiabatic expansion. It is irreversible adiabatic expansion. Irreversible means obviously the entropy of the fluid is increasing because of the dissipative, that is the friction, etc., real estate loss conditions. So, here entropy is always increasing, whether you may compress, pump, expand, whatever it may be, throttle, whatever it may be the process, irreversible process. Except the heat transfer, because this is a dissipative effect, entropy always increases. But in the heat transfer only, depending upon the direction of heat transfer, entropy will depend. For example, heat is added to the system, entropy will increase. If you are taking out from the steam, that is heat from the system, that is heat rejection, entropy will decrease. Now see, to find the state, actual state at the exit of the steam turbine with the given data, of steam turbine efficiency, isentropic efficiency, let us say for example this is 0.85, that is 85% of steam turbine isentropic efficiency is considered, then to find this to actual state at the exit of steam turbine, we have to define the steam turbine isentropic efficiency. Now this is enthalpy drop, actual enthalpy drop, this is isentropic enthalpy drop. Now you can see the actual enthalpy drop is less. But isentropic enthalpy drop is more. So actual enthalpy drop, if this is defined as actual enthalpy drop by isentropic enthalpy drop, delta H I. Now the actual enthalpy drop is H1. Minus H2, isentropic enthalpy drop is H1 minus H2 dash. But in the pump it is reverse, pump as well as compressed it is reverse. Reverse means we have to take the other direction, that is isentropic by rise by actual rise in the compressor. So coming to this turbine, H2 dash already we can calculate using this Mollier chart as well as the steam table. In case of Mollier chart, we can draw a vertical line in HS diagram. In HS diagram, in case of this is a H enthalpy drawing. So, the meeting point of this pressure as well as this entropy line gives the state. So, you can read the H2 dash. Coming to H2, that is actual state. So, the actual state is we can calculate from this equation, that is from this steam turbine efficiency. The actual state can be calculated as H2 is equal to H1 minus efficiency of the steam turbine as a number, efficiency steam turbine into H1 minus H2 dash. So this is the actual state once you consider the isentropic efficiency in the turbine. Similarly, the process can be repeated for the pumping also. In case of pumping with the irreversibility, a pump with the irreversibility. This is a pumping process. They are pumping from P2 to P1. For example, condenser pressure to the boiler pressure, water is pumped isentropically, means see here a small rise in temperature only in the pump. We can't expect more rise in the turbine. More temperature drop is there, okay, that is expanded way, but this is a contracted because these two constant pressures are diverging with each other. So, but because of the irreversibility, the entropy is increasing. Let us say this is 1, 2, is the pumping process. Instead of 1, 2, maybe I will use some other notations. Let us say as per your earlier Rankine cycle 4 to 5, for example 4 to 5 is a pumping process, and 4 to 5 is the actual pumping, and the 5' is a 4 to 5' is a isentropic process. Now the question is how to calculate the state 5. Again apply the definition of this pump efficiency, isentropic efficiency of the pump. Let us say this value is approximately 75% from the data. If I am giving the 75% of the isentropic efficiency for the pump, feed pump, then to define isentropic efficiency is pump, see temperature slash enthalpy start. Now this is the isentropic enthalpy drop, delta H I. This is actual delta H. Isentropic enthalpy drop is less than the actual enthalpy drop, but earlier that is different. In earlier case reverse. Now coming to the pump, the small value is isentropic enthalpy rise, actually is more, delta H, yes, enthalpy rise in the actual process. So that is equal to H5 dash minus H4 by H5 minus H4. Here what is the unknown? Unknown enthalpy, unknown state is 5. To find this unknown, that is H5, we can find H5 from by means of this equation, that is H5 is equal H4 plus H5 dash minus H4 by the isentropic efficiency of the